Hello, my darlings. Welcome to Cryptids Canada. I hope everybody's having a great day. I've got a great story to read today. Oh my goodness, I think you guys are going to love this one. So I guess that's about it. I hope everybody gets comfortable, sits back, put your feet up if you like, close your eyes, and enjoy the story. Okay, it is titled, Finally Wrote It. Hi, Leslie. I'm finally sitting down to write to you about some of my experiences. I have never seen a Sasquatch, but I have had other strange things happen that I cannot explain. This is not technically about cryptids, but I wanted to reach out to you anyway and share what I believe to be demonic experiences and warn people to not mess with a Ouija board. I am nearly 63 years old, and in my day, Ouija boards were in many homes and were considered a children's toy. We had one in our new house, and being the youngest of six children, I was the one who had continuous access to it. After all, my siblings had moved out. They say you can't play with the Ouija board alone, that you need another person to help you get the planchette going. That is not true. I would sit for hours alone in my room, asking it questions, and it would answer. Sometimes, other times, it would sit as still as a piece of plastic on a particle board. I didn't have many friends. We had moved recently into a huge house, and I missed my old neighborhood, my friends, the sidewalks, and my roller skates. This neighborhood made little accommodation for children, so the Ouija board became my friend. I was so lonely, and it was always there waiting for me to talk to it. We would converse day after day. Sometimes it would talk to me, spelling out answers to my deepest 10-year-old little girl's questions. I would feel an uncomfortable presence that I could not understand. I was drawn to it more and more. I began checking books out of the library about witchcraft and ghosts. I wanted to know what this thing was that I was talking to. I was raised in a Catholic family, but never did anyone ever hint that playing with that thing could be dangerous. Over time, I became more and more withdrawn. I was afraid of the dark. I began to wet the bed and I was having night terrors. I could see glowing, transparent people walking in the hallway or sitting on our old corner chair. The house was so creepy and I had a feeling someone had died there. I never connected those occurrences to the board. All little children grow. And so did I, and my parents decided we needed to move, which I thought was the best idea ever because all I experienced in that house was terror. In fact, they were moving because of my constant nightmares and my feelings of being watched at night as I tried to sleep. The last straw happened when I woke up in the wee hours screaming and ran full speed down the hall into their room, landing in the middle of their bed. It was the first time I saw my dad cry. The decision was made not long after to move. They picked a home very far from that little town. In my mind, I was leaving it all behind. So here we were in our new home, Ouija board and all. By now, I was 13 and a budding adolescent. I had turned to my Christian faith to help me and found comfort in knowing I had a Savior who cares for me. I began to make new friends, and all seemed well. My parents could not have been happier. Over time, I forgot about the Ouija board sitting in my bedroom closet. I had new friends, and I was doing well in school. My parents even bought me a horse, and I went riding every single day. I don't know if whatever that was that lived in or around that board got jealous, or if my new happy life was just pissing it off. But late one night, about 6 months after moving in, I woke up in the middle of the night to something very tall, very dark, and hooded staring down at me from the foot of my bed. What I mean by staring down at me is that it was either over 7 feet tall or it was hovering. I could not see its face. In fact, the robe it wore was completely black, and where the face should have been was even darker than the black of the hood. I felt the most evil presence I had ever felt, and I knew my life was in danger. I did not scream this time. I yelled, "In the name of Jesus Christ, Jesus, help me." My mother heard me. She bolted from her bed and ran into my room. She said she felt a thick, evil presence, like a dark blanket all over the room. She reached for the light, also saying, "Jesus, in the name of Christ." The moment that light went on, it was gone. We fell into each other's arms, and I was crying and telling her what I saw. I don't remember sleeping the rest of that night, but the next morning, my mom and I had a talk. We were both fairly educated by then about demons, but innocently believed that the terrors were left at the old house. We prayed to the Lord to show us what allowed this thing in. I saw a picture in my mind of the Ouija board. "Mom, do you think it could be that Ouija board?" she said, as she had never given it that much thought, "but just in case, we'd better throw it away." I told her I wanted to do one last test before we got rid of it. I took it off my closet shelf and I opened it. I sat it on my bed and placed my fingers on the planchette. I asked it a question. It did not move. I asked it another question. It did not move. I told it, "I'm a Christian now. Will you answer some questions for me?" It began to move. It went around in circles, past all the letters and numbers, 3 or 4 times, then flew off the top of the board. I wrapped it very quickly in a brown paper bag and took it to the dumpster. I did not have any more experiences like that until I was in my 30s. I will tell you about those later, if you think you would like to read them. I've got tears in my eyes as I'm writing this. I forgot the raw emotion attached to what happened. I know the light of God, our Creator, surrounds me now, and nothing can touch me unless it is His will. Listen, people, no matter how curious you are, just don't. Don't do it. Don't play with Ouija boards, angel boards, or anything else they're called. I know now that the house was not haunted. I mistakenly brought things through that portal. Who knows what havoc I released on people's lives through my ignorance. I can't take it back, and I have no idea where that thing went. Blessings to you, dear Leslie. I love your channel and your kind soul, and yes, your wonderful voice. Keep up the great work. We love you. Gratefully, Juliana Gatz from California. And then she goes on to say, "You can use my name if you'd like. I'll tell anyone who wants to know my experiences with the Lord of Hosts. He always wins." Oh my goodness, Juliana. Well, first of all, thank you for the beautiful compliments. It means a lot to me. But I can't believe the horror you went through. I wish, too, that people would just get it through their thick heads about these things. You just don't realize what you're doing or what you're inviting in when you play with those things. I do believe they should be definitely taken off the shelves in the children's department, the games department. And if you're insisting on playing with one of those things, there should be warnings all over the box. Anyways, guys, I've got some more time. I think I'll read another one. Oh, and yes, Juliana, by all means, send us those stories because I, for one, want to hear them. Okay, so on with the second one. "Hello, I really enjoy your podcast and listen most evenings. It has been fun to learn about this and see how similar everyone's experiences are. My dad was born in Canada. My experience happened just south of there in Maine. I grew up along the coast of Maine and my dad had over 19 acres of land that he bought in 1969, and we built our house on that land, which was several miles from town or our nearest neighbors. There was a small state park along the Kennebec River, and I grew up there from the age of 3. I spent a lot of time wandering and playing in the woods around all sides of our house, wandering the deer trails, jeep trails, and paths out behind our property and behind the houses of the neighbors down the road, closer to the state park. Sometimes we would see as many as 20 deer in our backyard, even as recently as 10 years ago. One afternoon in 1978, early fall, I went out back and down the long jeep trail to climb my favorite huge high tree, which we could see from our yard. As I made my way up the jeep trail behind our house, past a densely forested patch of wood to the deer trail that led to my favorite tree, I became aware of the sound of my breathing, and I noticed that the woods, for late afternoon, near dusk, seemed very quiet and unusually still. As I approached the tree and started to climb a little until I was about halfway up, I suddenly became very uncomfortable, feeling extremely visible and suddenly vulnerable. I was pretty high as it was a big tree, and I looked to one side and then the other as I could not shake the feeling that someone was watching me. I could not see or hear anything, but I became so uncomfortable, I abandoned my climb and started to walk back towards the jeep trail. I had never experienced any discomfort around our woods before, but I knew I did not want to be there anymore. As I headed down the trail, I could hear something rustling the leaves in the dense tree cover. I stopped to listen, and the rustling stopped. But as I started walking again, I could hear the leaves rustling again, and this happened about 3 or 4 times, which really scared me. Once I got about halfway down the trail, I ran as fast as I could till I hit the opening in our back lawn where our garden was planted and was within sight of our house. At the time, it never occurred to me that the silence in the woods, that spooky feeling of being watched and the sound of being escorted out of the woods might actually be something other than my active imagination. But I never told anyone, and soon I got too busy to spend much time climbing trees and grew up and I moved away. Just recently, it occurred to me from listening to your podcast stories, and as I remembered all of this, maybe there really was something out there. 2 or 3 years later, on the edge of the woods, near that large tree, I found an unusual teepee-style stick structure, which I assumed my brothers built. And when I asked my brothers about it, they had no idea who built it. Although it looked cool and that someone else had made it, the brush in the woods were too dense out there to walk through, and no one ever pursued it. Now I wonder maybe if I interrupted something while it was hunting a deer or something, and they were letting me know they wanted me out of there. I never actually saw anything, but I only felt it, and I heard the rustling sounds in the trees. That was enough for me, and I'm glad I trusted my instincts and left the area promptly. I do wish we still owned the property, because now, with what I know, I'd love to go back and explore a bit. The area has been built up quite a bit, and I hear about sightings a few miles west of where our house was, and it makes me wonder. I wanted to share my story as a little girl growing up in Maine, as I experienced a few things that are similar to these stories I hear on your podcast. I hope you enjoyed reading my experience. Probably best to leave my name out of it, though. Thank you for your podcast. Well, thank you for taking the time to sit down and send in your story. And I found it very interesting. And you know what? You very well could be right. I hear it all the time that people hear this sound of something mimicking their walking and the bushes crinkling and the leaves crinkling. And then later on, they actually see a Bigfoot. So we know beyond a doubt that they do actually do that. And I don't think I've ever heard of any other animals out there that, you know, will kind of walk beside you and mimic your footsteps. So I would assume that that was what you experienced as well. Anyways, guys, I guess I'm going to stop there. I hope you enjoyed listening into the story this evening. I'm sorry that I'm getting these videos uploaded so late. I'm going to try to get back on track again. Anyways, guys, you have a great evening, and we'll see you back here in a couple of days. Bye for now.